What's up? I am Ian Merton Allison here with SBL, bringing you a video that I have wanted to make for a long time. The 10 classic basses you need to play before you die. So before we get into it, you might be saying, Ian, what does classic basses mean? Here's the deal. I'm gonna define it in this video, just for this video, okay? To me, classic basses are instruments made in three decades, the 50s, the 60s, and the 70s. And you're like, aren't there iconic and classic basses made in the 80s? Absolutely. 80s, 90s, aughts, but that might have to be another video.
Alrighty then.
Let's get into it. All right, so if you're going to make a video about classic basses, you have to start with a 51 style Fender. So a lot of people will actually credit Leo Fender with the birth of rock and roll because of the bass guitar. Why is that? Before this instrument and before bass amplification, really, the band could only be as loud as the upright bass player in the band, right? So when this happened, and you got to plug it into that cool Fender bassman that you could buy as like a combo pack, all of a sudden the bass player could turn up and maybe even start to distort the amp a little bit, and rock and roll was born. And the reason they called it a precision bass, do you know this? Is because you could play it precisely in tune because it had frets, as opposed to an upright bass that was fretless. And a bass line that you definitely know that was played on this instrument, such a classic, late 60s, Jackson 5 with I Want You Back. Now, quick history of this, Wilton Felder actually recorded this bass line. A lot of people think it's James Jamerson. Wilton Felder was a saxophone player and he got called into the studio, played a 50s style, like single coil Telecaster P bass, and just made history with this incredible bass line. So another way that I use this voice, because I love the honesty and sort of the dry, airy, woodiness of the instrument and of this single coil pickup, sometimes I'll put on a little drive and a little bit of like tape echo and play with a pick, and then you get this character, right? It's different than a regular P bass. Next up, you know it, you love it. It is the Fender Precision Bass. This era of P bass, absolutely, I think, is synonymous with James Jamerson, who played all those great Motown tracks. This is a 65, his was a 62. Very similar, but let me just give you a little taste of James Jamerson. Ain't Too Proud to Beg. It's one of my favorite bass lines. It's not the most complicated one, but I love it so much. I love where the pushes are. And immediately when you play a P bass with flats, it just says Motown to me. I love it so much. Something else too about a P with flats is it has all this dynamic range. Like when I see Scott play, he has this huge range in his playing where he'll play something, but then he'll snap one. I love that sound. And I mean, we've heard it a million times, so there's something so familiar about it. Now, I just wanted to give you an example of a P bass with rounds also, just so that you can sort of side by side compare. Obviously, different fingerboard, different bass altogether, but the same pickup. And if you just change the strings on a P bass, it's a whole new world. You can either sort of lean Motown or you can lean rock and roll. And this one for me, I love this bass. It leans rock and roll. This is a 58 custom shop with a huge chunky sort of soft V neck. And it makes me want to get my Clash on. Paul Simonon, the bass line for Rock the Casbah, so fantastic. So in 61, Fender started to make this crazy bass. This looks like a guitar, I know, but this is called a Fender Bass 6. It's tuned E to E, just like a guitar, but an octave lower. So you can do things like play chords, which just sort of sounds crazy, but also like very cool, right? Now I also have a bit of spring reverb on here and a bit of tremolo, because one of my favorite classic bass lines, and it's actually a bass solo on a record, is Glenn Campbell with Wichita Lineman. It just makes my heart so happy. And it's so cool, you have these switches for the pickups, right? So I'm on the bridge pickup now. Middle pickup's also really lovely. Just sort of open and glassy. And the neck pickup. The neck pickup is awesome because if you want to turn off the effects, right? And all of a sudden, you can just play bass on it. It sounds like a bass. Next up, we have a 63 reissue of a Rickenbacker 4001 V63. This instrument coming from a Fender is like a shock. It's like, there's all this stuff you can't palm mute, there's this thing, right? It's like, whoa, what do I do with this thing, right? But it is such a voice. Of course, you know this from Roundabout, right? Yes, Chris Squire? The great thing about this instrument is it sort of has like two modes, I feel like. I feel like there's like bridge pickup, high output with drive for that sort of classic rock, prog rock thing. But then there's also neck pickup, no drive, maybe picking in front of the cover, and you have that like come together Paul McCartney thing. Next up is a 1966 Fender Mustang. And this was originally made as like a student model just to accommodate smaller body, smaller hands. There's something about the way the higher strings sound on a short scale. They sound bigger, and so I find that I can play things in this register, and it sounds similar in low end content to the notes down here. It's almost just more of an even sound. And a great example of a classic Mustang bass line is Tina Weymouth's line with the Talking Heads for Psycho Killer. You get this thing. Psycho Killer. Okay, next on the list is a 1966 Guild Starfire 1. This is one of my favorite basses. I say that probably about a lot of them, but this truly is special. 30-inch scale, although it's huge, like it's a giant bass, like big body, big headstock. I love that about this. Brazilian rosewood fingerboard, just a beautiful instrument. I play with this artist named Jeremy Messersmith and get to play this bass intro for a tune called Monday You're Not So Bad. Now, of course, you can play this bass without spring reverb and a pick, right? It kind of leans upright. It has just this nice. I love how articulate it is in the top. Again, just honest. Sometimes I feel like basses that have flat wounds, there's this honesty. You're not hearing all this overtone series. So you just hear this fundamental and the, like the mid-range character of the bass. I love that. Hollow body, short scale thing coming. Next up on the list, 1967 Hofner Club. This is really the bass that lets you get your Paul McCartney on. Even though you've got that Rickenbacker thing that he used for a couple years, this is the brand and sound that's associated with Sir Paul McCartney. I love the bass line he plays on Taxman. On that recording, I actually can't tell if he's playing with his fingers or a pick. Both sound so cool on this instrument. Just incredible bass line, such a great ostinato. I sort of think that Paul McCartney ended up playing in this register a lot because this part of the bass just sounds really good. Also, the notes die pretty quickly. Like it doesn't have big sustain at all. Some people sort of see this as a deficiency, right? Like, oh, my bass has a dead spot, or there's a note that doesn't sustain. But instead, why not embrace these things? And so if the note dies, why not make it a thing? Nothing screams 70s to me more than this bass. This is a bicentennial Gibson Thunderbird bass, 1976. You even got that eagle that says 76 on it. Ugh, I love it. A classic example in rock and roll of the sound of this bass is Tom Hamilton's bass line with Aerosmith for Sweet Emotion. And I think people always think of these as sort of like gritty rock and roll machines, but the top end is very sort of pretty and serene. And also notes just sustain, like as opposed to a Hofner, this thing really goes forever. You thought I was gonna forget the Fender Jazz. I have a 78 Fender Jazz Bass in Antigua, and so I wanted to be chronologically true. Obviously, the Jazz Bass came out 1960, it was invented, started to show up around 61. But boy, I fell in love with this 78 Jazz Bass years and years ago, and it's sort of become one of my main instruments. I feel very at home on a Jazz Bass. It's just a wonderful instrument. It was made sort of as the like deluxe model to the Precision Bass, right? And it has two single coil pickups, very simple volume tone control, and it has a fairly thin nut width. These 70s basses have a little bit more depth in the neck, which actually I really like very much. And boy, you can just get a lot of things out of them, right? I mean, who do we know? We know Jaco, that's that bridge pickup thing where you blend back to the bridge. Right? We also know Marcus. Right, and that's just both pickups on full. We know Geddy Lee, right? Maybe turn on some drive and all of a sudden you have. Who else do we have? We have Bobby Vega. Grab a pick, maybe. I like to maybe blend toward the neck a little bit for Bobby. Just such a fantastic instrument. All the sounds in it are so useful, right? So I use this bass a lot and roll it toward the neck pickup. What I find that it sounds like is that original P bass all the way back at the beginning of the video, the 51. It kind of gives me that sound, although I have rounds on this. Leans P bass, but doesn't have that kind of like that muffled character. Hey, so we're getting close, right? We're getting close to the end. What am I leaving out? If you want to see a deep dive on any of these instruments, like if you're like, man, I want to get into that 51, let's do a whole 10-minute video on that 51 P bass. I'm into it. Let me know if that's what you want to see. Let me know in the comments. Last but certainly not least, bringing us to the end of the 70s is this Music Man Stingray. Here's the deal. Leo Fender leaves Fender in 65, right? He signs a 10-year do not compete. And then in 76, gets right back to work, opens up Music Man, and really does another design that completely changes the bass guitar. This is one of the first active circuits. So you have a big humbucker that's pushed near the bridge, right? And you have an active preamp, so it's a little bit louder. You've got bass and treble controls and a volume control. So I first got introduced to the sound of a Stingray from Peter Gabriel's So when I heard Tony Levin play Sledgehammer. You put on a little octave, you put on a little chorus, brighten it up, maybe more than I want to, but that's the sound. Play with a pick and all of a sudden. Now look, I know that he played this on a fretless Stingray. I gotta put that on my want list. SBL, we did it! That was the 10 classic basses that you need to play before you die. I wanna know, what was your favorite one? Or what was one that surprised you? Please, like the video, subscribe, talk to me in the comments. I read all this stuff, you guys. Talk to me about how much I look like Scott Devine. Love that one. Talk to me about what you want to see next, and I am going to be making more videos for you soon. Thank you so much, and here we go. I'm gonna say it. I'll see you in the shed.